Dear children,
good morning.
I think all of you collected your textbook from the school. So, you have your new textbooks near to you. Am I right? Okay, now take the 10th page of your basic science textbook. There is an experiment to perform. Now, let's start our class by doing that experiment. Okay, now, what are the materials required for this experiment? Let's read the textbook. It needs blotting paper. So now we can use a normal white paper instead of it. Okay. Do you have red amaranthus leaves? Do you have red amaranthus leaves in your house? No, then don't worry. Teacher shows it you what will happen. Okay. Now, what is the procedure? Rub the amaranthus leaves on the white paper. You hardly rub the amaranthus leaves on the white paper. Leave it as such for some time. What will be the observation? A green coloration observed in the paper along with red color. Can you observe? So, the observation is a green coloration in the paper along with the red color. So, what is the result? In the experimental point of view, we say that it is the inference. Red amaranthus have green pigment along with red pigment, isn't it? The red amaranthus have green pigment and red pigment. Which is the green pigment? Green pigment is the chlorophyll. The process of photosynthesis is carried out by chlorophyll pigment. The red pigment, the anthocyanin, helps only to give colors. So, chlorophyll is present in every plant that can prepare their own food. So, the plants are also called autotrophs because they can prepare their own food material. So, they are called autotrophs. All the other organisms that depend on these autotrophs are called heterotrophs. Heterotrophs, autotrophs and heterotrophs. Here comes our activity number 1. Complete the experiment note given below. The first one is the aim. Aim to prove that chlorophyll is present in red amaranthus. Materials required. A blotting paper. Now we use a normal white paper. Red amaranthus leaves. And you have to fill the procedure portion and observation portion. And the inference is red amaranthus have red and green pigments. Chlorophyll is present along with the anthocyanin. Okay, you can now fill the portions of procedure and observation. When you write that portions, your experiment note is over. So these are the steps of an experiment note. Okay. We studied in the previous class about epiphytic plants. These plants that live on other plants and depend only for shelter is called epiphytes. Examples are orchids and vanda. These are the other two plants which are examples for epiphytic plants. Look at the picture. This picture shows minute leaves like structures. This plant is called a seedhathali. Do you see this plant in your locality? This is seedhathali and this is another plant called bulbophyllum. Its base portion is bulges, so it is called as bulbophyllum. Bulbophyllum and seedhathali is another two plants that is examples for epiphytes. So epiphytes are plants that live on other plants and depend only for a shelter. Examples are orchid, vanda, seedhathali and bulbophyllum. Here is our activity number 2, that is complete the concept map. Activity number 2 contains 5 boxes in which a center, that is epiphytes, which is surrounded by 4 boxes. 2 boxes were filled by vanda and orchid. The other 2 will be filled in by you. Okay, so complete it. So, we are studying about the plant world. Most of the plants prepare their own food by photosynthesis. So, they are called autotrophs. Some plants like epiphytes absorb moisture from the atmosphere and prepare their own food but depends on other plants for shelter. It will not do any harm to the host plant. Okay, now look at the picture. It is a picture of a loranthus. Do you heard about loranthus? That is ithilkanni. In Malayalam it is called as ithilkanni. It's also living on other plants. Is they have clinging roots like vanda? Can you see any roots for absorbing moisture? But they have green leaves, isn't it? They are green leaves that are capable of carrying out photosynthesis. Okay. Loranthus absorb water and minerals from the host plant itself. Loranthus absorbs water and minerals from the host plant, then prepare its own food with the help of leaves. It is not an epiphyte, am I right? This is not an epiphyte because it cannot absorb water from the atmosphere. It is harmful to the host plant as it may lead to the destruction of host plant. But it can prepare its own food. So it is a semi-parasite. It can be termed as a semi-parasite, that is a partial parasite. It is not fully dependent on the host plant. It just want to absorb water and minerals from the host plant and prepare its own food materials with the help of leaves. Okay. So, but it is harmful to the host plant. It may lead to the destruction of host plant. So, it is called as a semi-parasite. So, that is the story of Loranthus. There is a curious piece of information for you. That is, you are aware of the sandalwood tree. This picture shows the sandalwood tree, which is considered as a sacred one for making chandanam for religious and medicinal purposes. That tree is also a semi-parasite. That is, it lives on the soil, but it absorbs water and minerals from the neighboring plants. By using these absorbed water and minerals, it can prepare its own food through photosynthesis. So, it absorbs water and minerals from the roots of the neighboring plants. So, it is considered as a semi-parasite because it does not absorb water and minerals as its own. It steals the water and minerals of the neighboring plants. It's curious, am I right? So, examples for semi-parasites are Loranthus and sandalwood. Now, look at the picture. Did you see this plant in your locality? This plant is cascuta. In Malayalam, it is termed as moodilla thali. It has no leaves. It has only this yellow wire-like structures as plant body. It is a total parasite as it absorbs food directly from the host plant. Eventually, the host plant dies. This parasitic plants adversely affect the host plant and at last the host plant will perish. Examples for complete parasites or total parasites are Rafflesia. Do you heard about the Rafflesia? The largest flower in the world. So here is our next activity. Activity number 3. How the following plants differ in their food habits? Loranthus and vanda, orchid and cascuta, seedathali and a sandalwood tree. So you should have to write the difference between the food habits of these three pairs. Okay. So it is the time for concluding. Let's together memorize the points that we have studied. Plants are capable of preparing their own food by a process called photosynthesis. Chlorophyll is present in all the plants to help for this process. So plants are called autotrophs. Plants absorb carbon dioxide and release oxygen during photosynthesis. During respiration, plants absorb oxygen and release carbon dioxide like man. Some plants are epiphytes, that is leaves on other plants. Examples are vanda, orchid, seedathali and bulbophyllum. Some plants are parasites, two types of parasites, that are semi-parasites and total parasites. Examples for semi-parasites are Loranthus, sandalwood tree, etc. They absorb only water and minerals from the host plant. By using these absorbed water and minerals, they prepare their own food materials using their leaves. The second one is total parasites. Examples are Rafflesia and Cuscuta. They absorb the food directly from the host plant, and as a result of a parasitic plants, the host plants will perish. Okay, rest in the next class. It's over for today. Okay.